Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we're going to look at the definition and calculations for density. According to Google, density is the degree of compactness of a substance. Say what? You'll come across density in both chemistry and physics, where chemistry will use the letter D, and physics will use the Greek letter rho that looks like a lowercase p. I'm going to be using rho, but recognize you can also use D. Density is equal to mass over volume. Recall the definitions that mass tells us how much matter or how much stuff, and volume tells us how much space it takes up, which gives us a more logical understanding of density, how much space stuff takes up. We're looking at this intuitively, how much stuff is in there, meaning how heavy, and then how much space it takes up. If you think of a balloon that's filled with air, and a bag that's filled with rocks. They could be the same size, they take up about the same much space, but that balloon filled with air, you can probably just hold it with two fingers, but that bag of rocks will require two hands, and then it may even still be too heavy. I like to think of density almost as thickness, like how thick something is on the inside. Maybe this is where the concept of having a thick head, nothing gets through because it's so compact, comes from, but that's not what we're referring to. Density tells us how much space matter occupies, so how do we measure that? If density is equal to mass over volume, and mass is measured in units of grams or kilograms, but what about volume? Isn't volume measured in liters or in cubic meters? Which one do we use for density? And the answer is both. You will typically come across density in units of grams per milliliter or grams per cubic centimeter, recognizing that 1 milliliter is equal to 1 cubic centimeter, which is something we worked out in the conversion series linked below. Here's how I like to think of it. A milliliter is typically referring to fluids, and fluids can move around, take the shape of their container. So I can have a milliliter of water in the form of a big drop of water, and that takes up a certain amount of space. But if I were to take that same amount of water and force it into a tiny box, I would get 1 centimeter each for the length, width, and height, which gives me 1 centimeter times 1 centimeter times 1 centimeter, or 1 centimeter cube as the volume for this box that can hold 1 milliliter of water. It's easy enough to find density if you know what you're looking for. We know that density is equal to mass over volume, so let's start with a solid. Say I have a brick of metal, a perfectly shaped brick. All I have to do is find the mass by weighing it, and then finding the volume by measuring the length times the width times the height. Plug it in, and I get grams per cubic centimeter, or whatever units you're using. If I have a liquid, I can just as easily find the density. The only thing you have to make sure is that you account for the weight of your beaker. The way to do that is to first find the mass of the empty beaker, then add the water in and find the mass again. The total mass is going to represent the mass of the water, which you want, but also the mass of the beaker, which we don't want. So what you do is you subtract empty beaker from the total mass, and that will give you the mass of your water or the mass of the fluid. Then you look at the volume, so hopefully you're using something like a graduated cylinder, which gives you a very clear reading of the volume, and once again, grams per milliliter or a similar unit to find the density. But what if you're trying to find the density of something not so easy to measure, because it's not in liquid form, so you can't put it in a beaker, but the solid is not that easy to measure because it's got a lot of different pieces. For example, the crown in the Archimedes story. The story goes something like this. A king commissioned a crown to be made with pure gold. And when he got the crown, and it was beautiful, he was still worried that the artist mixed in an inferior metal and took some of that gold for himself. To figure out if the crown was indeed pure gold, he went to Archimedes. Now, Archimedes thought about this, but the problem was, in order to find out what it was, ideally he would have to melt the crown and do the typical mass over volume calculation. But that would destroy the beautiful crown. Archimedes didn't know what to do. And the story goes, he figured out how to do this by taking a bath. So if you ever stuck on an MCAT problem, maybe what you need is a bath. And what he realized was, if he fills a container with water and then submerges the crown, he can simply note how much the water volume increases when the crown is placed inside. Any displaced water would represent the volume of the crown. And this is what he's able to use when figuring out density is equal to mass divided by volume of the water displaced or volume of the crown. And if the density is equal to that of gold, the crown was pure. But if it wasn't, let's just say I wouldn't want to be that guy. You'll see a lot more of this when you're looking at density in physics, including specific gravity. Specific gravity is a ratio of densities commonly used with water. So we would look at the density of an object, compare that to the density of water, and since the density units will cancel, we get a unitless ratio that tells us this thing is X many times as dense as water. The logic here is something more dense than water is going to sink or partially submerge, and something less dense than water is going to float. You don't have to memorize these values, but as an example, the specific gravity of cement is equal to 3.15. This tells you that cement is 3.15 times as dense as water. Then if you look at something like wood, which we know floats, we expect it to be less dense than water. And while different woods vary, for example, if I look at oak wood, it has a specific gravity of 0.75, telling us it's 0.75 times as dense as water, meaning it's 3/4 the density of water. And here's a fun one. Blood has a density that is slightly greater than 1, which is why if you ever bleed over water, you'll notice it floats for a bit, but then slowly mixes in as it dissolves with the water. The density that you absolutely should memorize for the MCAT is the density of water, which is equal to 1 gram per milliliter or 1 kilogram per liter. Memorize both of these numbers, but you can see this worked out in the conversion video linked below. Another one to note, the density of seawater or salt water is 1.03 kilograms per liter, which would be 1.03 grams per milliliter. On the MCAT, close enough is good enough, but it's important to remember that seawater is saltier, and that means it's going to be slightly more dense, and this may come up as the logic behind figuring out some of your passages. One more that I want to point out is the density of diethyl ether, ET2O, which is equal to 0.7 grams per milliliter. This is 70% as dense as water. And while you don't have to know the number, I want you to recognize this when you're looking at chemical extractions. In extractions where you have two layers in a separatory funnel, how will you know which layer is the aqueous layer and which layer is the organic layer? If you're using something like diethyl ether, which has a density that is less than water, we know that something less dense is going to float. This means that your aqueous layer, which is water, is going to be the layer on the bottom, the one that comes out of that separatory funnel first. And the organic layer, your ether, is going to remain on top because of its lower density. Say you're asked to find the volume in milliliters occupied by 21 grams of ethanol, given that the density of ethanol is 789 kilograms per meter cubed. First, figure out what you're asked for. We want to find the volume, we're given a mass, and we're given a density. This should clue you in. Density problem is equal to mass over volume, but we're asked to find the volume given everything else. We have to isolate volume by bringing it to the other side, which gives me volume times density is equal to mass. Divide both sides by density, and that tells me that volume is equal to mass over density. Now we plug it in. We have a mass of 21 grams, and we have a density of 789 kilograms per meter cubed. The problem with this is kilograms is not grams, and we're asked to find the volume in milliliters, not meter cubed. So we have to convert kilogram per meter cubed into grams per milliliter. We'll set this up using given times ratio, taught in the conversion series linked below. This is something you should get comfortable either doing in your head or writing out minimal steps. The given in this case is 789 kilograms over 1 meter cubed. What do we use for our ratio? You should know that 1 gram per milliliter is equal to 10 to the third kilogram per meter cubed. How do we set this up? Remember, we want the units in our given to cancel out the units in the ratio. So let's set this up as a fraction over another fraction. That still works. What do we put at the top? The new unit. And what are the new units? Gram per milliliter divided by the ones we know, 10 to the third kilogram per meter cubed. This allows us to cancel out kilogram per meter cubed, giving us our answer in units of grams per milliliter, but we have to divide by 10 to the third. From here, we simply use the decimal trick. When dividing by 10 to the third, we just move the decimal back 3 spaces, which gives us 0.789 grams per milliliter. If you were overwhelmed by this math, I am too. So let's see if there's another way to do this. You can try to look at this a little more logically. We know that 10 to the third kilogram per meter cubed is a gram per milliliter. So every 1,000 kilograms gives us 1 gram. We have just under 1,000 kilograms, which means we have just under 1 gram. And how much less? Well, 0.789 of 1,000, which would give us 0.789 of a gram. Then we go back to our original problem and plug it in. We have 21 grams divided by 0.789 grams per milliliter. Units of grams cancel, giving us an answer in 1 divided by per milliliter, which is simply just milliliters. But what about the math? Don't let the math scare you. Try to find shortcuts, try to find simplifications, because you can't have a calculator on the MCAT. What we're looking at is 21 divided by 0.789. First thing we want to do is round. 21 is approximately 20. 0.789 is approximately 0.8. And from here, we use the decimal trick. By moving the decimal to the right, on top and bottom, giving me 200 divided by 8. If you recognize that 8 quarters would give you $2, then you can say 200 divided by 8 is 25. Or you can simplify a little. We can divide both the 2 and 8 by 2, giving us 100 over 4. And 100 over 4, you should definitely recognize as 25 for an answer of 25 milliliters. For even more practice on this topic, first, give this video a thumbs up. And if you're not subscribed yet, hit subscribe. And then visit my website to access the Stoichiometry and Reactions Practice Quiz, tailor.com/reactions.